pasti ketar-ketir nih sama Sasha. Selanjutnya ada Bupati Nunukan yang sudah memenangkan dua periode kepemimpinannya pada tahun 2021. Kenali Ibu Astrid Laura Hakim yang biasa muncul dengan senyum Pepsodent miliknya. Menjadi seorang polisi bukan hal yang tabu bagi pekerjaan tersebut. Bagaimana tidak? Dia lahir dari keluarga dan support yang begitu tentang. Ayahnya adalah Abdul Hafid Ahmad yang merupakan mantan Bupati Nunukan dan ibunya Haji Rahma Lepa adalah ketua DPRD. Jadi secara kekuatan politik, Ibu Asmin memang bukan orang biasa. Sayangnya keluarga ini punya track record yang sang ayah pernah divonis 2 tahun penjara karena sebuah kasus korupsi. Semoga jangan gak jahil kayak Bapak ya. Pindah lagi ke Bupati Karawang, kita punya Selika Nuraka Dian. Ibu Bupati yang bakal menjabat sampai tahun 2020. Sepertinya memang jadi sosok penaman. Hal terbukti dari komen-komen media sosial yang dengan ujian soal kecantikan. Tapi Ibu Bupati Karawang ini juga pernah lo tampil dalam beberapa film, mulai dari Surat Kecil Untuk Tuhan yang rilis tahun 2011 dan Sergeant Bob Behind the Boss yang rilis tahun 2021. Iya emang sih, kalau tidak dari komen itu, sih, pasti sedikit
Manti will join our event today as the speakers. I would also welcome the Honorable Dr. Inyoman Sukarna as Karm Hum as Director of Indonesia Institute of the Arts, Dr. Ana Rosmiati S.Pd. M. Hum, Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Design, Dr. D.R.A. Tati Harpawati, M.Sn., Dean of the Faculty of Performing Arts. We also thank you for the presence of all lecturers. The last but not least, welcome to all participants of the seminar today. Next, let me read the rundown of this webinar. The first is the opening. The second is singing the national anthem, Indonesia Raya. The third is presentation by Dr. Haji Muhammad Arif Jati Purnomo, MSN, from Indonesia, with theme Batik Esok Sore, and directly followed by question and answer session. The fourth is presentation by Ms. Mavis Vanessa Paris from Caribbea, with theme Exploring Art on the Federation of St. Kitts Nevis, and directly followed by question and answer session. The fifth is presentation by Mr. Ismi Putra Nurarfah from Ancient Egypt with theme Papyrus, the Pharaoh paper in Ancient Egypt, and directly followed by question and answer session. The sixth is presentation by Ms. Vanita Betty Admanti from Japan with theme A Magnificent of Asian Aesthetic, and directly followed by question and answer session. The seventh is closing. Now let's move to the second agenda, namely singing our national anthem, Indonesia Raya, which will be led by Afiftah Cahya Putri. To Afiftah Cahya Putri, time is yours.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Afifta. Okay, it's time for the main agenda, namely the webinar. Ms. Anissa will be the moderator of the webinar. Our moderator today, Anissa Putri Cahyani, SPD MPD, is one of the lecturers in Fakultas Seni Rupa dan Desain Institut Seni Indonesia Surakarta. She graduated from S2 FKIP Pasca Sarjana UNS in 2019. She worked as a museum tour guide at Museum Batik Danar Hadi, Solo, in 2014 until 2015, which became her valuable step in learning more deeply about batik history, characteristic, and batik motif philosophy, among other experiences, which is mostly related to English teaching, learning, and research. Please welcome Ms. Anissa Putri Cahyani. Ms. Anissa, time is yours.
Thank you for the warm introduction. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Honorable the faculty members of Institut Seni Indonesia Surakarta, Honorable the chairman of Batik Art Festival 2022, our speakers from four countries and lecturers and students, also distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, also the participants joining online today through Zoom session, good afternoon. Okay, I am Anissa Putri Cahyani. It gives me a great pleasure to be moderating this event today, especially in this international seminar entitled Artwork Across the World as a part of Batik Art Festival 2022, Institut Seni Indonesia Surakarta. It's a great occasion to see participants sitting in front of me and the audience seat with us today. While other participants are online on Zoom meeting, please give applause for all of us and Batik Art Festival 2022. Isi Surakarta, thank you very much. As we know, arts bring different people together. We could do better things with arts, and culture helps to appreciate others with their diversity. In today's webinar, we will get a closer look into various types of artworks, especially from Indonesia, the Caribbean, Japan, and Egypt. And we're so glad to have our four speakers today. The first one, Mr. Muhammad Arif Jati Purnomo from Indonesia. Good afternoon, sir. And then the second speaker is Ms. Mavis Vanessa Paris from the Caribbean. Hello, Ms. Mavis. How are you? Bagus, baik. Yeah, so welcome back. It's Isi Surakarta. You were here in 2017, right? 2018. Okay. Do you miss something from here?
Recording in progress.
Yes. All right. Mi ayam,
mi bakso,
okay.
Mr. Aan,
okay. Mr. Arif is here beside me.
Oh, Mr. Arif, hello.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for being here. We're so glad to have you here today, Ms. Mavis. Though it's from Zoom meeting, though. The third speaker is from Egypt, Mr. Ismi Putra N. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
What time is it there in Egypt?
Here, 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock in the morning?
In the morning.
In the morning. Okay, good morning then.
Good morning too.
Yeah. Thank you for being here, joining us in this international webinar. The fourth is Ms. Panitra Perdi Atmanti from Japan.
Hi,
Miss Vanessa.
Anissa.
How are you?
Hi, I'm good. Thank you for inviting me.
Oh yeah, thank you. You're most
right
welcome.
Now, it's 3:30 p.m.
Okay. Thank you so much, the speakers. So, excellencies, participants, ladies and gentlemen, so this webinar is about to start. Each speaker will present the material for about 20 minutes, followed by question and answer session before shifting to the other three speakers. And finally, the session will end after closing statement and conclusion. For the audience joining in Zoom session, it's a pleasure for us if you could turn your camera on and mute your microphone. Ladies and gentlemen, so this is the international webinar, Artwork Across the World. Our first speaker, Mr. Muhammad Arif Jati Purnomo, or Pak Arif Jati, from Indonesia, is one of the lecturers in Batik Mood Design, Batik Fashion Design, at ISI Surakarta. So Pak Arif has a lot of experience, especially in textile, batik design, and he started the career as a lecturer of batik in ISI Surakarta, starting in 1999, and he has several work experience. He started the career as an entrepreneur, also designer, and he also has a lot of experience in research and community service, but the recent research and community service is related to batik esok sore, which literally means batik morning and evening. In 2021, Pak Arif had research about the existence of batik esok sore pedalaman, and this year Pak Arif worked on the combination of ecoprint and batik tulis as the alternative for technique of creation about batik esok sore. About the educational background of Pak Arif Jati, he received his undergraduate degree as satu design tekstil or textile designing from 11 Maret University Surakarta, and the master degree S2 pengkajian seni rupa from Institut Seni Indonesia Yogyakarta. And recently he has graduated from ISI Surakarta. He has received a doctoral degree from this university. So Pak Arif Jati today will speak about batik esok sore, or batik morning and evening, literally means like that. Kepada Bapak Arif Jati, kami persilahkan, Pak.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Mohon maaf akan kami sampaikan dengan bahasa Indonesia. Puji syukur kehadirat Allah Subhanahu wa taala pada siang atau sore hari ini kita masih diberikan satu kesempatan untuk bertemu, kemudian juga mempresentasikan paparan kami tentang batik esok sore. Perlu diketahui paparan pada sore hari ini akan saya sampaikan tentang rekam jejak perjalanan batik esok sore. Batik esok sore adalah batik yang memiliki konsep pola pembagian bidang menjadi dua komposisi pola, motif dan warna yang berbeda antara dua sisi kain. Jadi bisa itu berupa kain panjang atau bisa dikatakan dengan jari, atau juga ikat kepala atau ikat. Nah, perbedaan komposisi tersebut dikaitkan dengan fungsi pemakaian yang bisa digunakan dalam dua kesempatan waktu yang berbeda. Jadi dua kesempatan waktu yang berbeda ini dikatakan dengan esok dan sore. Ada sebuah fenomena estetik yang cukup menarik untuk dikaji berkaitan dengan munculnya pola penataan kain panjang atau juga ikat ini menjadi dua pembagian bidang. Ini dikaitkan dengan kondisi masyarakat pada waktu itu yang sangat kekurangan, baik itu berupa bahan berupa kain maupun juga bahan pewarna. Jadi kondisi yang terpuruk menjadi sebuah alasan atau reasoning kenapa muncul batik esok sore itu, awalnya seperti itu.
Recording stopped.
Kemudian istilah esok sore sendiri itu di berbagai sentra pembatikan ini berbeda-beda. Ada yang menyatakan esok sore, ada juga yang mengatakan pagi sore, ada juga yang mengatakan enjing sonten. Enjing sonten ini di daerah Garut, ya. Kemudian ada yang mengistilahkan siang malam, ini di daerah Madura. Nah, latar belakang munculnya batik esok sore ini tidak bisa lepas dari dua tokoh pembatik Indo-Eropa. Yang pertama adalah Nonna Carolina Josefina von Frankoymen, dan yang kedua adalah Katarina Carolina, yang ini menikah dengan W.J. van Osterom, yang kemudian biasa dikenal dengan Nyonya van Osterom. Nah, dari dua tokoh pembatik Indo-Eropa ini akan muncul motif-motif dengan nuansa Eropa, seperti ada batik tudung merah, kemudian ada batik puisi dan sebagainya. Nonna von Kremen memulai usahanya di Surabaya pada tahun 1840. Kemudian karena faktor untuk mendekati konsumen yang pada saat itu Semarang menjadi pusat perdagangan, di mana di sana banyak para keturunan Cina kelas atas yang memang menjadi pembeli produktif dari karya-karya Frankoymen, maka Frankoymen menetap di daerah Ungaran di dekat Semarang. Nah, kemudian batik yang dibuat oleh Frankoymen itu banyak dikenal atau dikenal dengan nama batik Frankemon. Kemudian ada pun Nyonya van Osterom, ini juga memulai usahanya di Ungaran pada sekitar tahun itu, 1845. Akan tetapi ketika suaminya meninggal, kemudian van Osterom ini hijrah ke Banyumas, ya, sembari menjadi misionaris. Ya. Jadi van Osterom ini seorang misionaris, dia di samping menyebarkan agama Nasrani di Banyumas, dia juga membuka usaha batik di sana. Nah, karakter batik van Osterom ini biasa disebut dengan batik panastroman. Ya. Karena memang karakter yang muncul di Ungaran ini berbeda dengan karakter yang dibuat di Banyumas, ya, karena faktor kondisi kimia air yang ada di Ungaran berbeda dengan di Banyumas, sehingga warna merahnya pun juga berbeda. Nah, karakter inilah yang memunculkan istilah batik panastroman. Nah, Van Osterom itu meninggal pada tahun 1877. Karena tidak memiliki keturunan, maka diteruskan oleh dua keponakannya yang bernama Nona Williams dan Nyonya Materon. Nah, dari Nyonya Materon inilah yang akan memunculkan batik Esok Sore yang pertama kali pada tahun 1890. Nah, sebenarnya awalnya Nyonya Materon ini membuat batik Esok Sore ini juga hanya ingin uji coba ke masyarakat. Ketika itu diapresiasi oleh masyarakat, kemudian banyak digunakan pada waktu kesempatan pagi ketika ke pasar, kemudian juga ke sore, pada saat sore, maka nama istilah Esok Sore itu muncul secara naturalis di masyarakat pada saat itu. Nah, persebaran pada Esok Sore ini yang dari Surabaya kemudian ke Ungaran, dari Ungaran kemudian karena ada faktor-faktor kaitannya dengan perkawinan dengan yang ada di Pekalongan, maka sebaran dari Ungaran ke Pekalongan, kemudian ke Batang sampai ke Lasem, kemudian juga dari Banyumas ini juga banyak para pekerja dari Banyumas ini ke Garut. Nah, di Garut ini mereka juga membuat batik Esok Sore dengan karakter seperti yang ada di daerah Garut. Beberapa karya-karya batik Esok Sore yang muncul di sentra-sentra pembatikan yang ada di Jawa ini mengacu memang pada awalnya dari karya-karya Materon. Ya. Ada yang istilahnya dengan model sisian. Kalau sisian ini motifnya bisa berbolak-balik, ya, polanya bolak-balik, tapi latarnya ini sama. Kemudian ada latarnya dibagi dua yang berbeda antara sisi kiri dan kanan. Tapi motifnya, polanya ini bolak-balik dengan motif yang sama. Pada masa pendudukan Jepang di Indonesia pada tahun 1942 sampai 45, ini di berbagai sentra pembatikan di Jawa mengalami kemunduran, bahkan tidak beroperasi karena memang kondisi perekonomian saat itu sangat terpuruk. Sehingga yang muncul hanya beberapa sentra pembatikan yang ada di Pekalongan. Nah, batik Esok Sore yang ada di Pekalongan itu lebih dikenal dengan nama batik Jawa Hokokai. Nah, batik Jawa Hokokai ini merupakan batik yang merupakan masterpiece pada zamannya dan mungkin saat ini tidak ada yang bisa menandingi dari sisi komposisi warnanya dan kerapiannya pada saat itu. Karena memang kondisi saat itu memang memungkinkan untuk membuat batik dengan tingkat kehalusan dan tingkat komposisi warna yang sangat bagus. Mungkin sementara itu yang bisa saya sampaikan terkait dengan rekam jejak perjalanan batik Esok Sore yang sampai saat ini Esok Sore ini masih bisa kita lihat dan juga bisa dikenakan oleh para sosialita dan berangkat dari pola itu kemudian berkembang dengan Esok Sore kekinian yang memang tidak mengacu pada fungsi pemakaiannya tapi mengambil dari konsep Esok Sore untuk dipakai sebagai baju seperti itu. Saya kira itu, terima kasih, saya kembalikan ke moderator.
Baik, terima kasih Bapak Arief Jati. It's a great inspiring presentation about batik Esok Sore. So it's a pattern developed in Indonesia. It's created in the past because there was a limitation related to the cloth, related to the color materials. So this idea came from literally limitation.
in the society or in Indonesian people. And it was a long history, especially in Semarang, and because of the influence of Indo-European style, Batik Esok Sore or Batik Jawa Hokokai really happening in Indonesia until today. Okay, now I invite two participants for question and answer session. One question from the participant joining here in this building, and another question from the participant joining online. Any question from the participants here in this building? In front of me, about hundreds of people. One question for Pak Arief Jati. Okay. Yeah? Ada? Or maybe for the online participants, you can raise your hand. Okay, for the question and answer. Okay. No question. So if there's no question, maybe the participants are not ready yet. We could directly move to the second presentation. So maybe after listening to some presentation, more questions will arise. The second presenter, I invite Ms. Mavis Vanessa Paris from the Caribbean. She will speak about exploring art in the Federation of St. Kitts or Nevis. A little bit about Ms. Mavis Vanessa Paris. She began her career journey as a special education teacher. She teach learning disabled children. Also, she test and evaluate the performance of low achievers in the primary schools. It's in September 1994 until July 2007, and she continued to teach garment construction, textile, clothing, and fashion as a senior technical skills teacher from September 2007 until present at Nevis Island Administration, Nevis. Her education background in September 2017 until June 2018 at Penn Foster, she received her diploma in fashion designing in September 2018 until July 2019. She came to Institut Seni Indonesia Surakarta, this campus, to receive certificate in Batik Study Program. And August 1992 until August 1994, she spent her time at Harris Stowe State College, St. Louis, Missouri, to receive her diploma with capability to teach learning disabled, mentally retarded, and behavior disordered students. She also has other experience in sewing. She was certified in sewing achievement. Okay, Ms. Mavis, are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Okay, time is yours now. I know it's late there.
Yes, it is. But I have some so okay. I am good to go.
Yeah.
I want to say thank you for believing in me and giving me this opportunity. So to Jawa, Surakarta, and Isi, and all at the Pendopo, thank you. Now I present Exploring Art in St. Kitts, Nevis. St. Kitts and Nevis is a relatively young nation nestled in the Caribbean. It is a twin island federation that gained independence on the 19th September 1983. St. Kitts is 68 square miles with a population of 34,918 persons, and Nevis is 36 square miles with a population of 11,108, making it a combined population of 46,026. I am Nevisian. I was born and I live on Nevis. The culture is one born out of slavery and colonialism. We are predominantly English because we were colonized by Britain. The citizens are predominantly black. Art and culture works hand in hand for the Federation. However, we are just now seeing art as an economic opportunity. In St. Kitts Nevis, art is seen as an avenue for self-expression and self-enjoyment. There is no formal training offered in the schools, except in high school. There are clothing and textiles, art and designs, and subjects to choose from. Visual arts. Our greatest painter is Mr. Vaughn Ansley. He is Nevisian. He has represented the country in the USA, Dubai, and Taiwan. Vaughn specializes in portraits, but he explores other forms of painting. His paintings are very colorful and vibrant. He owns a fashion line and an event decorating company. You can see his work online in Facebook, Vaughn Ansley. Fashion design. Our sense of style is governed, change line. Our sense of style. Presenter, please change line. Our sense of style is governed by the American pop culture. There are a few persons who embrace African culture wear. Today we are plagued by a loss of values. Most persons are finding pleasure in wearing little or no clothes. The more revealing the clothes, the more attractive they are for our young people. There are a few established designers on St. Kitts who specialize in everyday normal clothes. Kiwidan is a fashion house located on St. Kitts. There is an emerging interest in avant-garde fashion that is experimental or radical. I have been working with them, with young people here in Nevis, to form an organization. Batik is an ancient fabric decoration technique that we practice. It is done on a very small scale. I was sent to Indonesia to learn more about it. Slide. There is one of these slides that I'm going to show, the one in the middle, the picture in the middle, show our batik styles. So those are the kind of batik that we produce. I was able to become enamored with the intricate work of Indonesian batik. Performing arts. Our government worked diligently in promoting our cultural dances. We have masquerade, giant despair, clown, cakewalk, Johnny Walker, and Moko Jambi. These dances are taught in school by the Cultural Foundation. Johnny Walker mimics gentrified Englishmen or men in parliament, men in government. Maple dancing, also called blue ribbon, they plait ribbons around a pole. Nega business. People dress in outrageous clothes and act out hot gossips of the year. Mokojambi. Folks walk and dance around on stilts. They wear brightly colored costumes. They represent the spirits of the dead going up to heaven and celebrating that they are not trapped. Mansion bull. A man dresses in a red outfit with a tail and a bull mask on his head. In this dance, the owner's bull gets sick from eating bad grass. The doctor is called, and the bull gets an injection that revives him and causes him to dance energetically behind the ground. Masquerade and Mansion Bull often participate in the Caribbean Festival of Arts. This event is staged every 2 years, hosted by selected Caribbean countries. I was just told by my prime minister that our masquerade also went to Dubai and Taiwan. Music. Slide music. The Federation is known for music derived from our ancestral home, Africa. There is a big drum band consisting of kettle drum, bass drum, and fife. We also have traditional African music. String band is a collection of string instruments accompanied by steel triangle, fife, a bajo, which is a giant bass flute, and a steel grater. These make up the percussion and is led by the fife. Death is a somber affair, but if the deceased was a musician, then music was a part of the funeral. The string band was a source of gaiety and a celebration. They put on performances throughout the villages in competitions and celebrations of birth, birthdays, and weddings. Steel band is made of instruments from metal drums. The drums are heated and beaten into shape to create many different sounds like bass, tenor, and soprano. Calypso is the main song form. It is an Afro-Caribbean beat accompanied by a brass band made of drum set, bongos, bass guitar, electric guitar, trombone, saxophone, and multiple vocalists. African drumming. These are drums made of animal skin spread across hollowed wood. Art does not play a vibrant economic role in its needs. However, the government is working on improving this. We want to showcase our talents. We want to showcase our talents around the world. We want people to understand our culture and appreciate our journey from slavery to freedom. My presentation here is a good start. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Ms. Mavis. It's a wonderful presentation. Yeah, it's a showcase of the visual art and performing arts there in Nevis. And I'm so happy to see the pictures. It's great. They look very joyful. They look very happy applying art. They play with arts. And I was wondering if there are communities or art communities in there that absolutely will be a good start, that will bring more contributions for the development of art there in Nevis.
Yes.
Okay.
We have the cultural foundation. Cultural foundation is the part of the government. Mm-hmm. That foundation was developed so that we can teach our young people our cultural independence and keep it going. Now we are exploring design and fashion. That is where I was placed to work. I am still a teacher, but I have been given the task to work with some young people to get them to think about fashion, not simply as everyday clothes, but as being futuristic, as being avant-garde.
Another nice thing, another interesting thing is that you brought batik there in Nevis so that people will start, you know, developing the techniques into the taste of Caribbean. What do you think?
Yes, well, like I said, we were already practicing batik, but the technique is the same. However, our philosophy was not the same.
Right.
For Indonesia, you know, your batik fabric is filled with patterns.
Yeah.
Ours are very random and very little bit. Mm-hmm. So it's like you will have this big 1 meter of fabric and you may only have five designs on it. Wow. So that is how our batik is. And I don't know if I want to change it. We are talking about it. And I think now we are saying that we want the batik to tell a story. So we are going to proceed to doing it differently in terms of adding more designs. Because people now want to order batik to celebrate a birthday, to celebrate the life of a child, a new baby being born, and a wedding, so they want to put a story in the batik, whereas before it was just put a picture on it.
Okay.
So my understanding of philosophy, from me going into Indonesia, I can tell them the best way how to do it.
Nice.
Yeah. I have a couple of workshops coming up where I am supposed to be teaching some people batik.
Right. Okay, yeah, it's interesting. I see the wonderful colors, I mean the colorful batik there in your picture, and it's really nice. Yeah. So batik will never be parted from the environments, also the culture of people, also the influence that were there in the area or in the region and in Nevis. So good luck, Miss Mavis, with this.
Yes, and I am going to close out and give you a little song.
Sure. Is this the music?
One moment.
Okay.
That was a slow calypso. Thank you very much. And that is my culture, my little island in the world, 36 square miles.
Okay. With 11,000 population.
Yes. Very small. So could you imagine me on the streets of Indonesia between all those motorbikes and seeing a lot of people? And especially when I go to a festival, it was an awesome experience.
Right, yeah. Nice to know that you have a good time in Indonesia, though. Yeah, we always
I love Indonesia. Mi baso.
Okay.
Yes.
Come here, Mavis. I'll treat you mi baso.
Yes.
Okay. So, question from the participants here in this building or from Zoom meeting. Do you have any question? Participants, we invite all of you. If you have any question, just raise your hands and we will invite you to speak. It was a great presentation from Mavis. Okay, still no question. Maybe in the end of the session, you will be ready. So thank you very much, Miss Mavis, for the presentation.
Thank you.
Now we move to the third speaker. It's Bapak Ismi Putra Nur Arfa. So he's actually Indonesian, living in Egypt. Dengan riwayat pendidikan, so the educational background, he studied at Al Azhar University, Egypt, 2016 to 2021, and he continued to study at master degree S2 at Al Azhar University, Egypt, from 2021 until now. He has some experience in organization related to Islamic studies, also some work experience at several pondok pesantren in Indonesia or Islamic teaching and learning, also pembimbing ibadah jamaah and many other experience. So I invite Mas atau Bapak ini ya.
Mas aja.
Okay, Mas iya. Ismi Putra, will you present in English or Indonesian, Mas Ismi?
Mungkin bahasa Indonesia atau
bahasa
Arab
kali ya. Okay, so Mas Ismi akan menyampaikan menyampaikan satu ulasan yang pastinya menarik, ini tentang Mesir ya. Berjudul Papyrus, the Pharaoh of Paper in Ancient Egypt. Jadi tentang papirus, sebuah kertas kuno ya, atau sebuah dokumen kuno, artefak kuno di Mesir kuno. Begitu Mas Ismi?
Ya, betul.
Monggo.
Baik, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Fa ahmadullah qailan amma ba'd. Pada kesempatan kali ini saya akan memaparkan tentang papirus, the pair of paper in ancient Egypt, atau papirus ya, si kertas Fir'aun era Mesir kuno. Jadi mungkin cukup menarik tentang kertas papirus ini, yang mana kertas ini sudah ada sejak masa era Fir'aun di era Mesir kuno. Baik, lanjut ke slide berikutnya. Di sini mungkin akan saya paparkan menjadi empat pembahasan mengenai apa itu papirus dan era Mesir kuno, dan juga tentang kertas kuno, papirus, si kertas kuno yang mencatat sejarah, dan juga berikutnya ada era Mesir kuno, di mana era di sana ada sebuah peradaban hebat dan kuat, dan berikutnya ada hieroglif Mesir, catatan yang hilang. Lanjut kepada pendahuluan tentang papirus dan era Mesir kuno. Nah, di sini ada foto tentang piramid, salah satu bukti sebuah peninggalan era Mesir kuno, yang mana peradaban itu masih ada sampai saat ini. Dan mungkin nanti bakal ada, akan ada foto-foto berikutnya tentang kuatnya atau penjagaan yang masih kuat daripada peradaban-peradaban di era Mesir kuno sampai saat ini. Berikutnya ada peradaban Mesir. Nah, di sini ada contoh dua bangunan tua. Yang pertama ada Hatshepsut yang di atas. Nah, yang di bawahnya ada Masjid Ibnu Tulun, yaitu salah satu masjid tertua di benua Afrika sampai saat ini. Nah, peradaban Mesir yang mampu bertahan selama ribuan tahun lamanya sampai saat ini, walaupun budaya, bahasa, tulisan, iklim, serta agama sudah berubah seiring perkembangnya zaman, akan tetapi peradaban Mesir yang kuat itu masih bisa bertahan sampai saat ini. Dan berikutnya, masyarakat Mesir kuno pada masa ini sudah mampu menciptakan sebuah terobosan-terobosan baru, yang mana mungkin zaman ini sekitar 3.000 tahun sebelum Masehi. Dan terobosan baru ini yang luar biasa ini dicatat dengan bentuk simbol atau tulisan fonetis alam. Mungkin pada masa saat itu tidak ada huruf ya seperti saat ini. Makanya mereka mungkin mencatat dengan istilah simbol atau tulisan fonetis alam. Yang mana simbol-simbol tersebut bisa dikatakan sebagai hieroglif Mesir. Lalu simbol dan tulisan tersebut mereka tulis di dinding kuil, bebatuan, dan lembaran kertas. Yang mana simbol-simbol yang mereka tulis ini mampu bertahan lamanya dari ribuan tahun sebelum Masehi sampai saat ini. Nah, itulah yang membuat kenapa saya tertarik mengangkat tema tulisan yang ditulis di kertas papirus, yang mana kertas itu masih bisa bertahan sampai saat ini, seperti itu. Nah, lalu berikutnya masuk kepada tema papirus, kertas kuno yang mencatat sejarah. Ini salah satu bentuk contoh dari si kertas papirus itu. Kertasnya sama ya, mungkin dengan kertas modern sampai saat ini. Mungkin warnanya hanya coklat, dasarnya hanya coklat. Nah, lalu masuk kepada apa sih papirus itu? Papirus atau bisa disebut tanaman kertas, yang mana tanaman papirus telah lama dibudidayakan di daerah delta Sungai Nil di Mesir. Yang mana tanaman-tanaman papirus ini itu banyak tumbuh di sekitar pinggir Sungai Nil atau muara. Muara Sungai Nil dengan Laut Merah. Lalu batang daripada papirus ini bisa diambil. Nah, tangkainya atau batangnya diambil, yang kemudian bagian tengahnya dipotong menjadi strip tipis. Ya. Kemudian dipadatkan, lalu kemudian direndam, dikeringkan, lalu dianyam hingga sampai berbentuk sebuah kertas. Lalu berikutnya, orang Mesir kuno menemukan jenis kertas yang disebut papirus ini, atau bisa disebut tumbuhan sungai dengan nama yang sama. Dan ini contoh-contoh kertas papirus ya. Nah, ini contohnya kertas papirus. Di sana juga ada kertas papirus yang atasnya ditulis simbol atau ditulis sebuah gambaran. Lalu papirus yang sudah jadi bentuknya sama dengan kertas biasa. Akan tetapi kertas ini anti air, bahkan sangat kuat dan mampu bertahan sangat lama. Nah, papirus merupakan pendahulu daripada kertas modern. Oke. Lalu kita masuk di proses pembuatan kertas papirus. Nah, di sini ada 8 step untuk membuat kertas papirus. Nah, ini ada step pertama, yaitu proses pemotongan dari batang pohon papirus, yang proses pertama. Proses kedua juga untuk menipiskan batang tersebut sehingga
jadilah di proses ketiga. Gitu. Dan di proses keempat, ini merupakan proses perendaman supaya papirus itu bisa lentur. Nah, yang mana kita lanjutkan di slide berikutnya. Nah, di proses berikutnya ini, di proses nomor 5 ya, di slide berikutnya. Di proses nomor 5, di sini ada proses penganyam. Penganyaman dan juga proses pengeringan. Serta proses penulisan. Apakah nanti akan ditulis sebagai simbol, apakah akan ditulis sebagai gambar. Mungkin di slide berikutnya, next slide. Operator.
Recording stopped.
Oke, lalu berikutnya masuk kepada tema era Mesir kuno. Ya, tema era Mesir kuno. Era Mesir kuno yaitu sebuah era peradaban hebat dan kuat. Oke, ada sedikit kendala. Baik, mungkin saya lanjutkan pemaparannya. Era Mesir kuno, sebuah era peradaban hebat dan kuat. Nah, mungkin kalau nanti di slide
recording
di sini,
in progress.
Di sini ada gambar sebuah peninggalan, yaitu mungkin di slide berikutnya. Oke, slide berikutnya satu lagi. Baik. Nah, di sini ada namanya gambar foto atau Abu Simbel di daerah perbatasan Mesir dengan Sudan. Nah, Mesir kuno di Afrika Utara adalah salah satu peradaban yang paling kuat dan berpengaruh di wilayah ini selama lebih dari 3.000 tahun sebelum Masehi. Bahkan telah berkembang jauh sebelum adanya peradaban Yunani kuno, Romawi, bahkan Mesopotamia lahir. Dan di era inilah era yang mana meninggalkan banyak sekali monumen, dokumen, karya seni, yang terus dipelajari oleh para peneliti sampai saat ini. Nah, dan salah satunya peninggalan tulisan ya atau sebuah dokumen yang ditulis pada kertas hieroglif yang ditulis di kertas papirus yang mana hieroglif tersebut ditulis di atas kertas papirus dan masih ada sampai saat ini. Nah, di slide berikutnya antara papirus dan era Mesir kuno. Kertas papirus pada era itu digunakan sebagai media penulisan naskah. Nah, ini ada contoh papirus dan juga contoh tulisan hieroglif. Tulisan-tulisan simbol. Digunakan sebagai media penulisan naskah keagamaan, nasihat spiritual, surat kenegaraan, catatan dokumen resmi, karya ilmiah, pencatatan medis, maupun karya sastra lainnya. Lalu hanya orang terpelajarlah yang diizinkan untuk menulis pada lembar papirus. Alasannya apa? Karena pada masa itu sulitnya proses pembuatan kertas papirus ini. Dan juga memang kertas papirus ini hanya dipakai untuk kalangan menengah ke atas, kalangan Fir'aun. Fir'aun itu kan artinya raja-raja ya. Mungkin kalau kita sering dengar, wah Fir'aun tuh, si Fir'aun ini seperti itu. Sebenarnya Fir'aun itu artinya raja-raja. Dari Raja Ramses I sampai Ramses ke-100. Lalu berikutnya kita masuk kepada pembahasan hieroglif Mesir. Catatan yang hilang. Di slide berikutnya ada hieroglif Mesir. Oke. Istilah hieroglif sendiri berasal dari kata Yunani. Nah, yang berarti ukiran suci yang pertama kali ditemukan dalam tulisan-tulisan Diodorus Siculus pada abad ke-1 sebelum Masehi. Hieroglif kuno. Nah, hieroglif kuno yang paling kuno berasal dari akhir milenium keempat sebelum Masehi, sekitar 4000 tahun sebelum Masehi, yang diukir pada stoples tembikar atau plakat yang bertujuan untuk mengidentifikasi orang mati. Lalu aksara hieroglif sendiri bisa juga ditemukan di dinding kuil dan monumen, atau berupa simbol yang ditulis di atas kertas maupun simbol yang ditulis di atas batu. Lalu tulisan ini bisa terdiri dari dua jenis, yang diukir pada patung, tembok, dan tulisan pada tinta lembaran papirus yang pada permukaan atau ditulis di permukaan halus lainnya. Lalu berikutnya ada hieroglif Mesir. Nah, jadi kan hieroglif itu banyak. Yang saya tahu di Cina juga bahkan ada hieroglif gitu, simbol-simbol hieroglif Cina. Nah, cuman yang di sini saya tekankan tentang hieroglif Mesir. Lalu hieroglif dikembangkan oleh masyarakat Mesir kuno sebagai cara menggabungkan tulisan ke dalam karya seninya. Berbeda mungkin dengan masyarakat-masyarakat modern saat ini yang memang mereka menggunakan huruf, masyarakat Mesir kuno lebih menggunakan simbol untuk komunikasinya. Simbol yang juga disebut sebagai hieroglif dapat memiliki lebih dari satu arti, tergantung bagaimana cara penulisan daripada si hieroglif ini sendiri. Lalu berikutnya, ini contoh hieroglif yang ditulis di dinding di sebelah kanan, dan juga ada simbol hieroglif yang ditulis di kertas papirus yang ada di sebelah kiri. Hieroglif Mesir merupakan simbol atau bentuk tulisan fonetis alam yang disederhanakan dalam gambar. Nah, bagaimana sih cara membaca huruf hieroglif Mesir itu sendiri? Nah, sesuai dengan karakteristik yang disimbolkan, sehingga menyulitkan para arkeolog untuk memahaminya. Karena sampai saat ini tidak ada data yang konkret yang memang menjelaskan makna daripada tulisan hieroglif Mesir itu sendiri. Sehingga menyulitkan para arkeolog ya untuk mengartikan makna daripada simbol-simbol tersebut. Lalu terdapat lebih dari 700 gambar, lambang dalam bentuk manusia, hewan, benda maupun simbol yang ditulis menyerupai aksara paku yang memang maknanya sangat sulit dipahami. Bahkan banyak sekali arkeolog-arkeolog dari luar yang meneliti tentang hieroglif ini sangat sulit gitu. Apa sih arti daripada paku ini? Apa sih arti daripada hewan ini? Apa sih apa arti daripada gambar atau lambang manusia ini, itu apa artinya untuk hieroglif Mesir? Bahkan karena memang tidak ada data atau tidak ada bukti yang menjelaskan tentang makna daripada benda-benda atau simbol-simbol gambar dan lambang tersebut. Nah, berikutnya ada contoh hieroglif Mesir. Nah, ini contoh hieroglif Mesir. Dan juga contoh hieroglif yang ditulis di papirus. Nah, di situ ada gambar pertama, paling atas sebelah kiri, papirus yang mana di atasnya ditulis simbol-simbol hieroglif. Nah, yang bagian tengah itu ada hieroglif yang ditulis di atas bebatuan. Dan juga itu bagian kanan bawah ada papirus yang mana di atasnya digambarkan tentang Abu Simbel atau sebuah peradaban kuno Mesir yang masih ada sampai saat ini. Nah, mungkin cukup sekian penjelasan dari saya tentang papirus si kertas Fir'aun pada masa era kuno. Seperti itu. Baik, mungkin terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Halo Mas Ismi.
Ya, halo Mbak.
Ya, ada pertanyaan dari Mbak Rima, apakah kertas papirus saat ini dijual untuk publik? Karena tadi kan ada tahap-tahap pembuatannya, pengeringannya begitu ya.
Iya.
So,
ya.
Is it for sale?
Iya.
Ya, ya. Ya.
Oke. Untuk sampai saat ini papirus era modern itu bisa dijual, Mbak. Masih ada. Di Mesir itu kalau di pasar-pasar Khonkholili atau pasar lamanya lah, pasar lama Mesir itu masih dijual kertas papirus sampai saat ini. Cuman ya memang gambarnya ada yang bentuknya simbol-simbol era Mesir kuno atau gambar-gambar piramid, Abu Simbel dan lain-lain. Intinya bisa dijual. Masih dijual sampai saat ini, masih ada. Dan masih dikembangkan dan diberdayakan sampai saat ini. Seperti itu, Mbak.
Apakah itu ada yang kosongan, maksud saya kertas papirus yang belum ada tulisannya?
Oh iya, masih ada. Yang kosongan juga ada yang dijual. Yang memang dia benar-benar pure kertas kosong, tidak ada tulisan di atasnya. Itu masih ada yang menjual sampai saat ini.
Fungsionalnya untuk apa, Mas Ismi?
Apa?
Aspek fungsional itu sendiri untuk yang papirus kosong, apakah masyarakat masih memanfaatkan kertas-kertas papirus okay. itu?
Oke. Okay. Untuk papirus ini fungsi masyarakat modern mungkin sudah tidak dipergunakan lagi ya, karena kan sekarang sudah ada kertas, bahkan sudah ada komputer dan lain sebagainya. Mungkin kalau di era masyarakat modern ini kertas papirus itu dipakai untuk pajangan, Mbak. Untuk pajangan dinding. Karena memang papirus juga sekarang nggak hanya ditulis dengan tulisan hieroglif saja. Bahkan sekarang kaligrafi pun sudah ditulis di atas kertas papirus, seperti itu.
Mas, ada lagi pertanyaan dari Mbak Fani Atmanti. Papirus yang sudah berumur sangat tua, saat ini apa masih bisa ditemukan di museum-museum bentuk fisiknya? Apakah tahu ada perlakuan khusus saat penyimpanan kertas papirus ini atau datanya tinggal digital saja? Is there any special treatments for the ancient papyrus in the museum?
Untuk bentuk digital yang pasti masih ada itu di Museum Egypt, dan untuk papirus sendiri kalau yang tulisannya yang saya tahu ya sampai saat ini untuk papirus pada era-era ribuan tahun lamanya itu memang masih ada di Museum Nasional Egypt, itu masih ada. Akan tetapi untuk yang hieroglifnya dalam artian papirus yang mana di atasnya ditulis kertas hieroglif itu sudah tidak ada. Sudah tidak ditemukan lagi yang memang pure pada era kuno. Akan tetapi kalau yang masih era ribuan tahun, era setelah peradaban Mesir kuno itu masih ditemukan. Gitu. Untuk treatmentnya sendiri, Mesir itu memang sangat menjaga sekali ya tentang peradabannya. Bahkan memang untuk masuk pun kita tidak diperbolehkan untuk membawa kamera. Gitu. Hanya diperbolehkan untuk membawa HP saja, tapi tidak diperbolehkan untuk membawa kamera. Mungkin untuk menjaga si papirus tersebut. Seperti itu, Mbak.
Satu lagi pertanyaan untuk Mas Ismi. Ini dari Zoom meeting ya. Mas Fuad Hashim, izin bertanya, jika papirus sudah ada sejak Fir'aun, kenapa pada era Nabi Muhammad penulisan masih dilakukan di tulang atau kulit? Apa teknologi ini dulu eksklusif atau tidak diperdagangkan? Begitu.
Oke. Kalau seperti ini kita berkaitan dengan era Fir'aun dan juga era sejarah Nabi. Peradaban yang pertama ini kita era papirus ini itu berada di wilayah Afrika. Nah, di wilayah Afrika. Sedangkan era Nabi itu mereka berada di Arab Saudi Arabia. Nah, yang pasti dari Mesir ke Saudi Arabia aja itu sangat jauh. Mungkin pada saat itu papirus hanya memang dikembangkan di Afrika Utara saja gitu, atau di era Mesir, di daerah Mesir dan wilayahnya saja, tidak sampai dikembangkan kepada sampai Saudi Arabia. Seperti itu. Makanya mungkin kenapa di Arab Saudi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam Allahumma shalli ala Muhammad, beliau menulis di tulang atau di batu. Seperti itu. Mungkin ya karena memang kalau misalkan kawan-kawan ke Mesir atau ke Saudi, karena papirus hanya ditemukan di apa namanya pinggiran Sungai Nil saja tanaman papirus. Sedangkan di Arab Saudi tidak ditemukan tumbuhan papirus. Seperti itu. Sedangkan Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam di Mekah dan di Madinah pada masanya. Seperti itu. Ada ya, pertanyaan yang lain?
Ya. Ya, untuk participants yang ada di sini, di depan saya, apakah ada yang ingin bertanya untuk Mas Ismi dari Egypt? Silakan. Oke. Okay. Belum ada pertanyaan nampaknya dari peserta yang luring di pendopo isi Surakarta. Baik, terima kasih sekali Mas Ismi. Dari penanya juga berterima kasih atas jawaban yang sudah disampaikan. Semoga sukses studinya.
Sama-sama, mohon maaf kalau ada sedikit kekurangan dan salah kata. Akhiran, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih.
Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you.
Question.
Question? Sorry.
Yes.
Oh, there's one more question from Mafis. Yes, Mafis. Miss Mafis.
What took him to Egypt? As an Indonesian, why did he go to Egypt?
What? Mungkin bisa di... Can you repeat the question, maybe?
Why did you go to Egypt?
Where? Gimana, Pak? Kurang jelas. Pak, Mbak Moderator.
Speaker... The speaker wants you to repeat the question. He's not really clear about what you're
saying. Yes, but you can translate for him. Is he living in Egypt? Why did he go there?
Oh, are you living Okay. I live in Egypt only for study. After finishing my study, I go to Indonesia. Of course. I just study in magister. I'm only studying, not living well here.
Okay.
Let's come to Egypt.
Thank you, Miss Mathis.
Yeah. I met Damasis from Egypt. I go to Egypt. Welcome.
Ahlan wa sahlan. Kumasar. Welcome to Egypt.
Thank you.
I think Mas Ismi is in his first year of PhD. Right, doctoral degree.
Betul.
Yeah. Okay. Baik, terima kasih Mas Ismi sekali lagi saya ucapkan. So, we move to the last speaker. It's Miss Fani Atmanti. You can find her on fanitra.com. So, our fourth speaker received, still doing her PhD in Tsukuba University 2022. So it's her first year of PhD until 2025, especially in heritage architecture and management. She also had her master's degree of World Heritage Studies from the same university, that is Tsukuba University, especially in heritage architecture, management and planning. Also, she studied at Gajah Mada University back then in 2006, graduated on November 2011. She majoring in architecture engineering. And there are many awards and competitions, also working experience. So she
focus on the design, interior design, also visual and creative, and architectures. She also has focus on furniture designers. Also, there are some publications related to architectures and art experience. She became the speaker at TEDx Jakarta, presenting Wisdom from the Field, the Structural Genius of Nias Architecture. And now she's staying in Japan for her PhD. And also there are some art experience related to designs. I cannot read it by one by one, but architecture and management, especially heritage architecture and management, is the focus or the interest of Miss Fanny Atmanti. So now today, I guess Miss Fanitra Perdi Atmanti will speak more about a magnificence of Asian aesthetic. Okay, Miss Fanny, time is yours now.
Thank you so much, Anissa, for introducing me, and also Isi Suratara, and also Babat Art Festival for inviting me to this presentation. Right now, I actually want to share about my experience and also the product that I create. Actually, my educational background is architecture, and then from architecture, I moved to product design. So I want to start with a video. I talked with the committee, and I will share screen by myself. Let me check. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so I will play 1 minute video and then start the presentation. Okay, so let me share the PDF. And okay, hope you can see my screen. Okay, so the previous video is a jewelry that I actually create with my friends. And why from architecture to product? So I might tell a little story. So this is my hometown. I was born in Yogyakarta, and I live nearby Pasar Ngasem, so nearby a cultural heritage. And also after I graduate from Yogyakarta, I moved to China, and I live in Beijing and Shanghai, and there I learned about East Asia architecture. This is a picture when I visit Heaven Temple with Tibetan people. So start from there, I'm interested more in heritage architecture. And then some of my friends asking me about my roots as an Indonesian, but I recall my memory that actually when I study in Gajah Mada, we only have a little study about heritage architecture. Then it makes me curious with heritage architecture and finding my own roots. And then I moved to Japan. I study heritage architecture and work as an architect. And also in Japan, I learned about Japanese architecture. Like in Tokyo, you can still find traditional architecture, but surrounded by modern building. And when I look back again, the architecture project that I joined, this is a house, a private house in Kanagawa. So the owner want to have a sliding door, so it mixed with contemporary materials, but they still have the traditional elements on their house. And this is an expo 2025 after Dubai will be in Osaka. So the office I work on this, and then it's using a ring. In the middle is a pavilion, and the structure of the ring is using wooden structure. It's also inspired by traditional Japanese architecture in Kyoto called Kiyomizudera. And this one project in China, they make a kind of an exhibition place in Shenzhen, because Shenzhen is a center of Silk Road. And then they won, and in this place, they opened the gate to the for trade, and also foreigner can come to China. So they want to make the Shenzhen opening reform. And then in this project, I study about the Chinese traditional pattern for the window, and then they applied with using modern material. And then, so that is the work that I always work in, is always contemporary related to the heritage. And then actually my research is about Nias Island in northwest of Indonesia. And then I research about the house, and then the problems. And also after researching about the adaptive reuse, I'm thinking to make a product. The reason is in 1970, so they lost some of the forests because it's owned by the private. So when they want to make the renovate the house, they need money, because before they can take the forest, the tree from their own forest, but right now it's owned by a private. So they still want to live in this house, they want to renovate. So they kind of, there's a problem in this kind of materials, the extension of material. And this is the entrance of the house. The house is really big. The tall is 20 meter tall. You can see that they live in the middle below only structure, and above they don't use it because they believe in a spirit. So underworld they don't use it for living. Middle world is the earth which they live in, and above is upper world is for a spirit, so they keep it vacant. And then at the time I'm thinking, because when they do renovation, you can see that there's some waste wood, and then sometimes they just throw it, or sometimes they make it into wood carving. And this is a kitchen, so they use like wood, and they use charcoal, and have a kitchen inside in the middle of the house. And you can see here, you see on the right side, there's a really huge sculpture. So Nias people told me that only few people want to buy, and it's a bit hard to send the sculpture from this small island to another island. And then, but they still need more income to renovate, to maintenance their house. And then the idea of this OMO projects came out. And this is also the villager of Nias. They do a wood carving with really with the recycled wood that I show you in the previous slide. And this is also the carpenter sit next to me. And then me and my friend Karin Lim, she's also a designer from Singapore, and she invent the transformation bag. But then we collaborate with this. Okay, let's collaborate with Nias people, and we try to use the recycled wood. So this is from the column of the house. And then the dark brown is called Berua wood. and the light brown is called afoa. It has a fragrance. So from this wood, we create something that is light. So we think how to create something that is light so it's easy to distribute, since it's so hard to access the village. You need to fly from Medan, from Jakarta, you need to fly 3 hours to Medan, Sumatra Island. And then from Medan, 1 hour to Nias, Gunung Sitoli Airport. And from there, by car, 4 hours, and then climbing a mountain. And so when we create this, we think, oh, we can easily distribute the product, and then people in Java or another island in Sumatra, Sulawesi, they can have this product, which is super light. When you don't use it, it can be flat like this, but when you use it, it can be 3D. And it's from the old wooden column from the house. And so this is the first idea. So for the coloring, so we try to experiment and also collaborate with the Nias villager. The black one using a charcoal, like you see in the previous picture, they had a kitchen in the middle of the house. And then they usually color their wood carving using charcoal, become black. And the white one, we use the chemical. And then the brown one, we use traditional materials called gambir. It's part of the, it's kind of a plant. So you, Nias people usually use it for sirih. Together use it as a, with the betel nut. And then the last one is a prototype using wood paper. And so this one, so this bag using wood connected with leather and using a sling, also leather. And then, yeah, it has been exhibited in Tokyo in 2016 and also another exhibition next month in Tokyo. And the first one is Nias Island and Omo bag. And the second one is the jewelry that I showed the video on the first. So these two image is just a collection of my sketch during visit some ethnics in Nias Island, from Nias Island to East Nusa Tenggara. And this one is in West Papua in Danau Sentani, in Sentani Lake. Usually can find this kind of pattern in a Maro. Maro is a bark cloth that you can find since the Neolithic period. You can find in West Papua. And then from the sketch, I communicate with the villagers, and they have some symbolism and some important jewelry like a bracelet, the head, and also symbol of the mythical creatures, which is related to their belief. And then there are a lot of beautiful meanings, and I try to transform into jewelry. And so this is the first collection. So from left is, it's called Gere, Tela, and then this is Saro, Lani, Suku, Sege, and Ule. This is, I recreate the symbol from the sketch, the symbol from the tribe that is important and inspiring, and create into a new jewelry that can be used in daily. And it's made from silver, but then it has a rhodium plate on it. And so this one, after 1 year using, and it get morphed, so it's kind of the color look like wash, is what we want to achieve. Because when we visit some of the tribe, they have some jewelry that they use for festive rites and cultural festival. They have a really beautiful color. It looks like this. So the silver plaid with rhodium, and then for 1 year using, it become morph like this. And for the packaging, we also thinking, so the packaging, we use a thick wood and GRC. So this is a glass fiber concrete. Why we use wood and concrete? Because Actually, we have a discussion that in architecture, especially in Indonesia, there's a lot of like paradox and a lot of problems. Right now, the industrial building came, industrial material came, so many craftsmen use concrete instead of wood, and then the skill of wood disappearing. So by making this as a packaging, we want to kind of remind some Indonesian about, I hope in the future, the wood craftsman is not disappearing. And then this, we also collaborate with Sokola Institute. If you watch movie Sokola Rimba, so the benefit from the selling of this jewelry, we also donate to Sokola Institute because we want to give a donation also for education for some tribe which live located in isolated place. And then, so that is the two product that is inspired by the Indonesian culture that I made. And of course, this is also two designer from Japan, Yuji Yamamoto and Issey Miyake, which also one of a figure that inspires me, since they have a really strong, the really strong signature for their design. They are Japanese, but during the war, Yuji Yamamoto moved to Paris, and then because of the World War II experience, and then he moved to Paris, and he creates some of the idea that his clothes is like layering of black, asymmetric. It's kind of a show of rebel of what he's experienced during World War II. While the Issey Miyake, he's also moved to Paris, and he's as a Japanese move abroad. He create something contemporary product, but inspired by Japanese culture. So I guess from this boat, fabric designer, I kind of inspired by them, by looking back what is happening in their own country, and they create from that spirit. And this one is also the inspiration of the folding bag, because in Issey Miyake they create a clothes that can be folded into 2D and become 3D. And yes, I think this one is my Instagram. Of course, I'm really open to like collaboration. I would love to. And thank you for listening to my presentation and looking forward for the question. Saya tunggu pertanyaan-pertanyaannya. Terima kasih. I think I cannot hear Anissa from Zoom.
Hello.
Okay. Oh yes, I can hear you.
All right. Yeah. As I said, it was another inspiring presentation from the perspective of design, especially the architecture, also the buildings, also how it's inspiring, you know, a fashion industry, and it's so inspiring. I mean, Japan is a source of inspiration of Asia, and you really presented another perspective that we really appreciate. Thank you, Miss Fanny. Yeah. So we have a question here from Danisa Octaviani. Oh no, from Rima. Rima asked about how to incorporate classical aesthetic into modern clothing design. Bagaimana untuk menyatukan estetika klasik ke dalam desain pakaian modern, begitu kira-kira Mbak Fanny.
Okay. Saya bisa jawab bahasa Indonesia atau bahasa Inggris? Oh,
dua-duanya. Bisa, bahasa Inggris.
Okay. Untuk menyatukan pertanyaan yang bagus, karena pertanyaan ini adalah pertanyaan setiap desainer.
Okay. Bagaimana
bisa menyatukan ini? Tapi bisa melihat dari salah satu desainer yang tadi saya sebutkan di presentasi isi niyake, dia bisa menyatukan itu dengan cara teknik yang digunakan itu menggunakan teknologi modern. Misalnya saat dia membuat lampu, lampu itu bisa ditekuk menjadi dua dimensi. Bagaimana bisa menemukan teknik itu? Dia bekerja sama dengan dosen di bidang informatika. Lalu dosen itu membuat suatu software yang bisa membentuk sebuah pola. Lalu pola itu diterapkan di material tradisional, material lokal, yaitu washi paper. Dan jadi bentuknya terlihat contemporary, tetapi menggunakan material tradisional. Dan bagaimana bisa menemukan itu juga harus dengan coding dan software. Jadi dari satu kertas, lalu bisa menemukan garis-garis, dan di saat ditekuk bisa menjadi tiga dimensi, dan ditekuk lagi bisa menjadi dua dimensi. Itu yang saya lihat dari Jepang. Jadi ada percampuran dua itu, materialnya yang bisa ditemukan di sekeliling, karena kita berada di negara itu. Kalau misalnya di Indonesia bisa dicari di sekeliling situ, tetapi teknik pembuatannya modern, seperti itu. I think we cannot hear your voice again. Anissa, in Zoom, we cannot hear your voice.
Hello? Hello?
Oh, yes, we can hear now.
Okay. Yes. Sorry, that was technical issue right there. Okay. It's interesting because Japan is very famous of its origami products. So yeah, I think it's very beneficial because it's from the flat shape into 3D. It's a very simple concept, but when it comes to big ideas, they can apply it too. Jadi bisa diimplementasikan di hal-hal yang besar, ide-ide yang besar. Itu spesialnya Jepang ya, Mbak Fani ya. Alright. Yeah, yeah. The next question is, apakah inspirasi terbesar dalam konstruk suatu unique design? Bagaimana menemukan signature kita sendiri sebagai desainer? Itu Mbak. Kira-kira dari Mbak Danisa Oktaviani, silakan.
Okay. Sangat menarik. Apakah inspirasi terbesar? Saya lagi-lagi melihat beberapa desainer yang ada di sini, mereka selalu inspirasinya itu dari kegelisahan-kegelisahan yang terjadi di hidup mereka. Jadi kita tidak fokus ke bentukan seperti apa, tetapi melihat pelan-pelan di sekitar kita ada masalah apa. Misalnya kita bisa melihat dari Yoji Yamamoto dan Issey Miyake. Waktu itu Yoji Yamamoto tinggal di saat Perang Dunia Kedua. Lalu dia melihat, dia bekerja di tailor, ibunya memiliki toko tailor, dan di saat itu mendapatkan klien wanita yang waktu pesan baju, dia melihat selalu wanita diharuskan memakai baju seperti a doll-like, seperti boneka, dan bagi dia itu sangat tidak manusiawi. Lalu dia tidak menyukai adanya itu, dan ayahnya pergi perang untuk dan banyak korban di situ. Dan di saat itu kegelisahan itu membuat dia membuat baju sekarang penuh dengan layer. Dia ingin membuat saat orang untuk wanita khususnya, kalau yang Yoji Yamamoto, dia ingin membuat baju yang membuat wanita merasa aman. Lalu dia pergi ke Paris dan dia membuat untuk signature dia dari pengalaman yang dia dapat waktu kecil. Kalau Issey Miyake, dia ingin, karena masuknya industrialisasi di Jepang, dia khawatir akan hilangnya satu sentuhan satu sentuhan craftsmanship di Jepang. Jadi sekarang setiap produknya Issey Miyake selalu menggunakan filosofi, material, atau teknik tradisional. Dan kalau saya sendiri, ini ada pertanyaan bagaimana menemukan signature sendiri di saat ingin mencari tahu, ingin belajar keluar Indonesia, ada banyak pertanyaan tentang negara saya sendiri, tetapi saya memiliki info yang sangat sedikit. Lalu saya pergi ke Nias, dan di situ ternyata ada arsitektur yang sangat keren menurut saya, dan ternyata mereka mengalami masalah sangat besar, misalnya hutan tahun 1970 yang dulunya milik mereka, lalu tiba-tiba itu memiliki pihak asing, lalu mereka kekurangan uang. Karena dulu kan mereka bisa ambil kayu dari hutan mereka sendiri, tetapi lalu sudah milik pihak private. Dan dari masalah itu ingin membantu dan ingin membuat adanya sistem yang sustainable sehingga mereka bisa maintenance rumah mereka sendiri. Dan dari itu ada kepikiran untuk membuat tas tadi, lalu juga ingin memperkenalkan karena saya sebagai waktu kuliah melihat untuk arsitektur yang saya dapatkan banyak materi itu dari barat, tetapi vernakular atau tradisional Indonesia sangat sedikit. Jadi dengan memberi produk ini bisa memperkenalkan lebih dalam tentang simbol-simbol dan budaya-budaya Indonesia yang ratusan, yang sangat beragam dari Nias, Nusa Tenggara Timur sampai ke Papua, ya, dari setiap suku. Jadi kalau untuk menemukan signature bisa melihat dengan apa yang membuat kita tertarik dan apa yang paling membuat kita gelisah tentang apa yang terjadi di sekitar kita. Itu menurut saya. Terima kasih.
Mbak Fani, bahwa saya pikir ada satu benang merah yang bisa ditarik di sini dari speaker pertama, dari Pak Arief Jati sampai ke Mbak Fani, bahwa kreativitas itu malah justru muncul ketika ada kegelisahan dan permasalahan. Juga sama dengan Mavis tadi, produk-produk budaya dan sebagainya itu bahkan justru muncul dari adanya ketertindasan, perbudakan, dan itu membuat suatu kreativitas malah muncul, inovasi-inovasi, ide-ide besar itu malah tercipta, begitu ya. Ya, so thank you very much speakers. So now, once again I invite for questions. We still have 10 minutes left. Masih ada 10 menit untuk bertanya. Jika teman-teman, participants here in this building ada pertanyaan kepada salah satu speaker kita pada pagi hari ini. Silakan. Atau dear participants, if you have some questions, you can type the questions in the chat box, please. And there is a attendance list for the participants. You can fill out the form. Bisa dicek di chat box. There's an attendance list. There's a Google form that you can fill out as a proof that you attend this conference. Sorry, this webinar. Okay, so if there's no more question, then I will invite the speakers to say a closing statement for our today's webinar. Jadi, it's about the artwork across the world. So related to our speaker's topic for the presentation, the first we have Batik Esok Sore, and then the second we have the Nevis culture. It's about the performing arts and visual arts that Ms. Mavis has just presented. Also, we have papyrus from Egypt, from the ancient Egypt, that's now still available, but for decoration purpose.
And then the last one we have architecture and fashion inspirations from Japan, especially Japan culture, and to be broader, it's Asian aesthetics. So now I invite the speakers to say a closing statement for today's webinar, started from Pak Arif, Pak Monggo, closing statement-nya untuk webinar hari ini tentang artwork across the world. Seperti apa, Pak?
Untuk closing, saya melihat dari perjalanan baik batik esok sore, kemudian dari batik yang ada di Karibia, ya, kemudian papirus, semuanya, kemudian dari Jepang tadi, memang ada satu keterkaitan seperti yang Mbak Nessa sampaikan, bahwa dari sebuah keterbatasan akan muncul sebuah potensi yang sangat dahsyat, sehingga keindahan yang mungkin secara paradoksal itu bisa terlihat, dan itu memunculkan sebuah potensi yang sangat-sangat luar biasa seperti itu. Jadi itu yang bisa saya sampaikan untuk closing, dan selamat untuk webinar pada sore hari ini. Sukses untuk semuanya. Oke, terima kasih.
Matur nuwun, Pak. Yeah. Alright. Terima kasih Bapak Arif Jati Purnomo for the closing statement. So he also emphasized that limitations cannot really stop your creativity. So in paradox way, limitation can be the source of ideas, can be the source of inspiration to create new things and great ideas. Begitu kira-kira closing statement from Mr. Muhammad Arif Jati Purnomo. The next speaker, Ms. Mavis Vanessa Paris, I invite you to say a closing statement for the audience today about artwork across the world. Ms. Mavis, could you please? Hello, Ms. Mavis. Ms. Mavis, would you please say a closing statement for our webinar today?
Yes. I was muted and speaking and didn't realize. I am sorry. I am honored to be chosen to be a part of this webinar. I learned a lot. My time in Indonesia, I view it as a wide cultural experience where I viewed your architecture, I viewed the carpentry, and I fell in love with it. Now I am happy tonight for the opportunity to see that young Indonesians are traveling the world to see how they can improve and inspire other Indonesians to keep the culture going. I know culture change, culture is dynamic. Young people are not going to think the same as older people. So we have to embrace that we want a little bit of the old culture to travel throughout the generations so that we can understand where we come from and where we are going. And to do this, we realize that we do need some financial contribution. So I understand where the presenter from Japan was talking about these inventions that allow them to transport things that are lighter, because the cost of transport is very high now. I wanted to buy some fabrics out of Indonesia for my business, and the war and COVID has made a great impact, great economic impact. So I want to encourage all the young people, everyone present, to know that culture is your identity and to embrace it and to pass it on to your children. I thank you. From the end of Nevis, I am doing my little bit. I am passing it on to my daughter, who is highly skilled in art. As a matter of fact, she's studying culinary arts. And so I too is doing my bit to maintain our culture in our part of the world. Thank you.
Good luck in everything that you are achieving today. And hopefully we can do the recommendations that you just said. That is by knowing and embracing our identity, our cultural identity, then we can do financial contribution, economic assistance or economic development for our country in the future or near the future. Thank you very much once again, Ms. Mathis. Next, you're very welcome. And now we invite Mas Ismi. Would you please give us a closing statement?
Sebelumnya, akan banyak untuk bisa ikut berpartisipasi dalam acara yang sangat menarik ini. Setelah dengar pemaparan dari pemateri pertama sampai terakhir juga, saya melihat seni itu bukan dari apa yang kita lihat itu, tetapi dari apa yang membuat orang lain bisa melihat atau bisa notice kepada seni tersebut. Gitu ya, intinya seni itu, art itu like make a peace, gitu. Sangat bikin tenang lah, seperti itu Mbak. Mungkin itu saja dari saya, terima kasih.
Arts are what people see in us, right? Okay, thank you very much Mas Ismi, semoga lancar studinya di Egypt, mudah-mudahan banyak memberikan kontribusi baik secara ilmiah maupun non ilmiah terkait dengan seni kebudayaan khususnya di Indonesia dan di Egypt. Baik, so the next closing statement we would like to hear from Mbak Fani Atmanti. Miss Fani, please, would you please give us a closing statement related to art across the world, artwork across the world?
Okay, thank you again for EC Surakarta and Batik Art Festival. It's really amazing that honestly, from the first to the third speaker, I've never heard about it, so about the topic. So today I learned a lot that, for example, in Batik Esok Sore, talk about the Batik Jawa Hokokai, even though I learned a bit before about Batik, but it's my first time. So, and for the second speaker, talk about what is happening in the Nevis, and also they want to promote the culture from the slavery to the freedom, which is really beautiful, and also how papyrus is preserved in the Egypt. So what I'm thinking is actually culture is really diverse, and also for me, when we see that culture, we don't, if we want to preserve culture, doesn't mean that it should be like that. So developing in culture is possible, collaborating is possible, and preservation is needed, because in the future, if we want to learn from the past, we need to know the documentation, the archiving of that. Because there's a saying that one time, if the culture is disappeared, then the civilization will disappear. So I think we need to preserve our culture, and we also give a space for culture to collaborate with another so that it will be sustained and it will last forever for our identity. And yeah, thank you.
About the identity preservation, also the collaboration that is very important to do in order to make it sustainable, to make the cultures around the world that are very diverse to be sustainable until forever, maybe. Yeah. So this is the end of our webinar, international webinar. I really thank you, ISI Surakarta, especially Fakultas Seni Rupa and Design, for supporting this event. Also the Committee of Batik Art Festival 2022 and the presenters for the great artwork presentation, artwork sharing across the world. It's all awesome. I really hope to see all of you and your works again in the near future. And the last but not least, for the participants joining here in Pendopo, ISI Surakarta, and also online, ladies and gentlemen, for being cooperative participants today. Thank you very much, and I think we deserve more applause for all of us. Thank you. So here's the end of our international webinar today, entitled Artwork Across the World. Preserve the culture, let's do collaboration. Thank you and have a great day. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yes, good night for me.
Good night, Mavis.
All right, thank you very much for all our speakers today. Thank you very much, Ms. Anissa. It is such a pleasure to have you today. Ladies and gentlemen, we finally come to the end of today's agenda. Let us close the seminar by reciting Hamdallah. This is the end of our agenda today. We hope you learned something. Thank you so much for your attention. See you next time. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Have a good day, everyone. Thank you.